talk on Waterfall to weekly releases. My name is Tathagat Varma, and I'm going to talk about one of the experiments that I did about 10 years back. We were actually having a waterfall based process for a product that I was managing. And we experimented with some of the ideas from Evo. Anyone familiar with Evo? So Tom Gilb, who is one of the thinkers who has been around in the scene for a long time, unfortunately, a lot of his ideas are not kind of mainstream. But I think Tom Gilb has done a lot of wonderful work there. And then Kanban, and of course, I want to be careful when I use the word Kanban, because Kanban did not exist at that point in time. So David Anderson's work, if you have read the book Kanban, you would read about how some of the teams in Microsoft at Hyderabad, they were actually doing some of the stuff there. And it's just incidental, the coincidence that we were also doing some of the work at Bangalore when I was at that company. It was a company that I used to work for McAfee, and we came out of McAfee. So it's some of those experiences. So what I went through in 2003, actually I signed up for, Tom Gilb had come down to Bangalore. He used to come to Bangalore very frequently. So I had attended a day session, a workshop by Tom Gilb on Evo, and that gave us some of the ideas on how we could apply some of the things, because he actually talked about weekly release cadence. So for us, it was a very radical thing, that going from a very waterfall way of thinking into a weekly cadence of how do we do that. So we took some of the ideas from Evo, and then Kanban kind of a thing was something, to be honest, we didn't know. So I would very honestly say that it was a serendipity for us. We discovered some patterns, we stumbled upon certain patterns without really knowing what we were doing. So I'll talk about that and take you through that journey of how it unfolded. Talking a little bit about our product, we were in the network management domain. It's been 10 years, I can talk about the company I used to work for. Anyone from network management domain here? Anyone has heard of Sniffer, the packet sniffer? So this was Sniffer. I was heading the Sniffer India engineering operations at that time, and this was the packet sniffer. So basically, you look at the TCP/IP packet or any of the packets that you are looking at. Payload, of course, it's encrypted, so you cannot look at the payload, but you're looking at the header of that, and you are playing around with the header, you're deciphering it, you're basically trying to understand. So that's what we were doing for a living. The specific name of the technology being deep packet inspection is what we were doing, and protocol analysis. It was essentially Windows-based, and we actually used to sell that as an appliance. So we had specialized hardware. We would actually have Ethernet, fast Ethernet, and other kind of things. And we would sell them typically as appliances, and they were essentially regular Windows-based. There was nothing real-time about it. They were installed in data centers, typically for traffic monitoring, analysis, and network troubleshooting. And they were generally not put on the production network, just so that you get the context of it. So we were not the most important lifeline of those data centers, because we were not on the production networks. But still, people needed to use us whenever they had a problem, so that they could do the troubleshooting faster, they could localize the problems much sooner, and so on. The typical users of our appliances were technical folks, so CIO, network manager, network engineers, and that's what we would basically do that. And it was a typical enterprise play, and the selling cycles typically would align with quarterly or annual budget cycles. Because what used to happen, there was a lot of capex involved in that. So there was a lot of capital investment, and it just was the way the enterprise software used to be sold 10 years back was like, so if I'm a sales guy, I have quarterly sales quota, and it just tends to happen that before the quarter expires, I have to kind of make sure my quota is met, otherwise I don't get paid, right? So typically we would see a lot of those kind of deal blocking feature requests coming literally at the end of the quarter, because hey, if you can deliver these three features, then I can sign this deal with this Fortune 100 client, right? So that is how typically it used to happen. And many times the sales would require customer specials, like I said. So the deal would not be signed until we were in a position to commit that, hey, we could deliver that feature. So there was a lot of push from the sales side to the engineering to do that. So in 2003, our old process would look something like this. We would have customer bugs. They were prioritized based on multiple business parameters. For example, severity was a typical way we do that. impact on revenue. So what is the revenue lying on the table that's going to get impacted by that? Or especially if we do not implement that, the volume in terms of, well, how much we have sold it to a particular customer, the competitive nature that somebody else is pitching there, and if we don't do it, then the deal is not going to come through. So multiple of these factors. The age of the case itself, how long that's been open. And I will show you some real data from that time of how long some of these bugs had been and feature requests had been open. It was just a humongous amount of backlog lying over there. So we had actually, the team was in Bangalore, and we had the program manager in San Jose, and program manager would typically prepare the plan of record, and then he would get the buy-in for various types of MRs. A typical process at that time would look like a very episodic kind of a process. So we would have a service packs where we would bunch up 50 to 60 issues, and they could be feature requests, there could be bugs, and every quarter we release them. So what we do is typically every quarter we are working on these 50, 60 issues there. They are not in any particular priority among themselves, but they are just there as a bucket, and we just have to get done all those things. And then if there is an urgent issue, we would release a hot fix. And if there is a specific thing, we might even do patches there. So this is how typically the process used to be there. The service packs would typically have, we just had a very simple way of doing it, where we'd say above the line, below the line kind of a thing there, so that we had some negotiation power on the table with our tech support and with our sales folks that hey, if we run out of time, then we will not do this. So this was how we did that. Now it sounded very simple kind of a process which normally should work, but we had tons of problems with that. So I'll just list out some of the problems. We had a development team at that point in time which was supposed to take care of these issues as well. But what tend to happen, and I joined the company in 2003, and I realized that the developers were not willing to sign up for any of these service packs or bugs. Because what tend to happen is they had signed up already for the dot releases, as we used to call them. And after that, they just didn't have any bandwidth to take care of some of these issues. So they would not do any maintenance releases. We had a huge pile of customer escalations without home. Home was a term that we used to signify that there is a version or a release vehicle we have identified. So if there is a bug in my Bugzilla, then I know, okay, this goes into 4.7 SP1, this goes into 3.1 SP2. That was a home. So we had a situation where a lot of these customer escalations were lying orphaned because nobody was willing to sign up for them. So they had no home, really. And they were compounded by high incoming field rate. 10 years back, the group I used to lead had a major. Because there was nobody to work on them. The development team. Yes, so what would happen is maybe a very high priority kind of a thing would be there, but you would be actually shocked when I show you the real graph of before and after that some of the 7-1s would be lying. We had 7-1s open for like 200 days. Which was okay because, well, people were willing to wait for that. It was not a SaaS kind of a thing. It was like, so it was, see, SLA is a different thing than the severity, really. I mean, we didn't really say that just because there is an SLA on that, then we would really do that. The tech support was responsible for prioritization. We would not do that. So tech support would do prioritization based on multiple of these factors. But the challenge was, and that became the crisis for us, that there was simply nobody to deal with such a high incoming field rate and all those 7 issues there. On paper, we had a team. On paper, I was making the commitment that we are going to do the SP1, SP2. We would try and do that, but what would happen is that SP1, SP2 were all episodic in nature. So I have to wait for a whole quarter before I can ship something out. But in between, if one of my Fortune 50 customer comes back and says, hey, I need something there and this is really causing us trouble, we had serious limitation. We'll have to drop everything else and get somebody to just work on them for 2 or 3 weeks. And then somehow we would go back and deliver the patch. And what we would realize is because of the configuration system not being such a robust one, we would typically like override that when we do the dot that service pack there. So the short answer is we did not have a lot of these things in place because the developers were, there was only a development team. There was no separate team that was working on them. So if I pulled out a developer from the team and said, hey, can you work on this? The developer was working on only the main development main line actually. there was no separate service line there. So they would have to do something on that and try and do that. So there were challenges because of that. We had a low closure rate, largely due to no dedicated resource, as I said. So there was nobody really owning that. We had a large wait for customers to get bug fixes. Tech support often tasked the team directly and broke the process, as was typical case of a startup. So it was a group within McAfee. It was an acquisition by McAfee in 2006. And then I was running the group from India. What happened in 2003 was that we came out of McAfee and became a private company because we were acquired by two of the big private equity guys. So we became a pre-IPO private company. And like a typical startup, we were actually, people would call up all over the place and just somebody would call up, even the CEO would call up sometimes the team and say, hey, can you work on this? I mean, that it was like a typical startup kind of a thing, right? So sometimes that would just break the process because there is nobody who's really keeping the sanctity of the process. The hot fixes were not available to all customers. So if my Fortune 20 customer came and literally shouted down at the other end of the phone to my CEO, then my CEO somehow passed on the grief back to the team, then I would do that. But then I have no systematic way to make sure that particular issue which other customers might be facing, I can send it to them. Because we have to ship CDs those days. So we literally had to wait for that. Sometimes a new bug might even break a hotfix. So that was because, like I said, the version control was pretty bad that time. And if a hotfix failed in the field, rollbacks would be very difficult. So that was another problem for us. Difficult to estimate time to resolve the bug and give an ETA. Now, the bugs themselves were not something that you can actually time box. If anyone has been in the business of fixing customer issues, there are few things that you would know. One of them is that they follow a stochastic bug arrival pattern. They actually follow a Poisson distribution. So we looked at Scrum was known to us at that time in 2004 when we thought of it, but we said, hey, we will not be able to splice down every single thing into a weekly cadence. We looked at Evo as a model and said, hey, every bug, sometimes it takes 2 months, sometimes it takes 3 weeks, sometimes it takes 2 hours. And severity and the time it takes to fix have no correlation. I could be working on a Sev 1, which takes me 6 months to fix it, or I could be working on a Sev 3, which takes me 1 year, but there could be a Sev 1, which I fix in 20 minutes. So there is no correlation between these two. So it's very difficult to kind of create a time box way of doing releases and say, hey, I'm going to be done in 2 weeks. A story you can split, but a bug you cannot split like that. So that was a kind of a inherent issue that was there. The high priority bugs could arrive anytime, theoretically, because that's just the nature of it. Like I said, it's a Poisson arrival pattern. That's what a bug arrival follows from the field. The customer specials also could arrive anytime with top priority, because anytime we had a customer who was bigger than us, we had to make sure that we found a way to satisfy their requirements, right? So that's a way. And there was a high internal rejection rate of bug fixes by tech support. So 2003 is when we opened up the Bangalore center. The team was still coming up to speed on that. And we didn't have enough technical depth in the team to really do that. So we got about 6 or 8 guys from the US team who were in the process of moving back to India. So that's how we were able to seed up the team and do that. But still, we did not have the right capability to fix the issues better. And they used to be invariably rejected by the tech support team, which was again in San Jose. So that's how it used to happen. And in 2004, 2005, we worked on a new process. We had this bunch of stuff there. I had just joined in 2003, and then I was busy in setting up the India operations. And then as soon as we were done, we started looking at our engineering process. So we actually created a very simple process. We created a dedicated customer sustaining team. So we said, these people are only going to work exclusively on fixing the customer issues. They will not write new features and create more mess. They will only clean up the mess, which is already lying there, right? Because one thing we realized, like in your teams, who creates bugs in the product? Just think about it, right? It's we developers who create the bugs in the product, right? And we get paid to do that. So we said we'll pay people to fix the bugs, but they will not write any new bugs there, right? And then we created a so-called new cumulative hotfix process, which allowed us to basically, exactly to the point you said, improve on some of the configuration management things that were already problematic and broken there, and improve the collaboration with all. We had the same version. See, there are multiple patches going on at that time, and different developers So what would happen is tech support knows, I know if this is a particular thing on the device driver, I will go to this engineer, and that guy is sitting in Plano in Texas. If there is an issue on the Armon monitoring, then I know this guy is sitting in Bangalore, I'll go to him. Now what is happening is, the tech support guy is kind of running a PMO operations there, and he is actually sending the things there. Nobody else knows. These developers don't know among each other. Somebody might be overwriting the file because there is no separate branch in which we are really managing it. It was like a typical startup. If that actually makes you very curious, I will tell you something. I am now an independent agile and lean startup and design thinking coach and consultant since last 6 months. I've been to some of the most successful and well-known startups in India, and I've talked to them, and you will be actually shocked to know that their process is totally broken. What I'm telling you, horror stories of this 10 years back look like fairy tales actually in front of what I have seen. It's a miracle, and in fact, I at one of them I was talking, I asked the entire team of 70 people, how many of the people here are doing test-driven development, they are refactoring their code, they are doing CI builds. Not a single hand went up in the air. And I told them that you are going to have your Salesforce moment. Anyone knows the Salesforce moment? In 2006, Salesforce had a problem when they could not ship a single feature out for one full year because it was so broken, their processes were so broken that they could not ship anything out for one full year. And then they decided to go from 0 to 100% agile in just one quarter. So it was a big bang approach they did, but they had such a big burning rig that they had to take such a radical step. So I actually, what I find is, this sounds like a work of fiction, but what I see today, even in, and I'm talking about some of the best names that we know in India in terms of startup space, they are all driving fantastic $500 million valuations. A lot of them is broken actually. It's all shiny hood, under the hood, there's a lot of problem there. So it actually needs little more different type of a rigor to really get some of that stuff there. So this was Evo, which actually, like I said, I attended one of the workshop by Tom Gilb and learned something about it. Of course, we did not imbibe all the principles. These were the 10 principles that are a part of Evo. We took up some of them. So that gave us some of the opportunities to do that. Like for example, decompose by performance results and stakeholders. Sounded like a very agile way of doing it, where we said, hey, every time you do something, it's like 2%, 4% of the features that you're releasing, you kind of deliver the whole meal and not really half-baked kind of a stuff there. So we took some of the elements from there. And then we started kind of doing it. So this was one of the poor quality pictures from that time, where we actually started looking exactly to the branching and said, how do we really look at branching the code and start doing that. And then we created this cumulative hotfix process where we actually started creating the branches in a little more methodical manner and said, hey, this is how we'll have the gold branch, and then we'll fork out a branch for the service pack so that we are able to do them. And cumulatively, people are checking into the service pack branch so that what's happening is, and again, this was the time when we did not follow any test-driven development. There was no QA automation. Again, the kind of work that we were in, my QA team actually was, if anybody is from networking space, they will know what I'm about to say now. My QA engineers were essentially all CCNA, CCNP, and some of them were CCIEs. That was the level of rigor that they needed. The developers knew how to write a BGP OSPF or some of these complex protocols, but the QA guys had to simulate a topology in which they would simulate like 100 routers or 500 agents or whatever is the need of there. So they needed to understand the network topology. It was not just a regular black box QA where they could just do any kind of a testing. So there was a lot of things that were there on the table. So we needed to have a way to kind of manually do at that time. We also changed the way we were doing the releases. Earlier, we used to actually have a very episodic way of doing the releases. So like I said, it was a 3 months journey. We would run for 2.5 months, and then in the last 2 weeks, we would start integrating them together, and like a typical waterfall, run into all kind of problems. We immediately brought it down that every week we were doing a builds. Now that itself was a huge thing for us 10 years back. Today, a lot of us would say, what is one week build? I'm doing build on the go actually, right? Whenever I'm doing my CI, I'm doing those builds. But at that time, that was a very radical thing for us to do. But what made it really possible for us is something that I'm going to talk about now. So just pay close attention, because I've tried to do some amount of animation here to show what the process looked like. So this is how our process would look like. We had the PMO sitting in San Jose, and he was the person responsible for basically prioritizing and allocating the issues to the team. We had a CST manager. The CST manager would be responsible for basically working with the 15-member team that we had. And these 15-member team was responsible for entire company's products. And they represented competencies in GUI, in backend, in device drivers, in protocols, and so on. And they had some experts in each of these areas, right? In theory, we might say, and that's to me a little more controversial, because especially when we talk of agile and immediately jump to Scrum, sometimes we use the term fungible in a very, very derogatory manner. It's like, oh, it's fungible resources. I have a problem with that phrase because, first of all, fungible is a bad idea for software developers, and resources is yet another bad idea, right? So I hate both of these things. So these were all people who had proficiency. So the people who were in the device driver team, they were not the people who would understand how to write a Windows code for GUI. They were experts. They were deep experts in device drivers. They knew how to write fast Ethernet or device drivers for wireless or 11ABG or what have you. So that was the level of competency. And as much as we want to make people generalizing specialists, and I believe in that, by the way, the fact of the matter was that these people had a specific competence, and no matter how much anyone wanted, they just could not go and do that device driver work. That was just the way it was. So the CST manager had to continuously make sure that the work was being, and then there was a QA team, and this was in Bangalore as well. The PMO was the only person who was sitting in San Jose except the tech support guy. So the tech support was again back there. Rest of the entire team was in Bangalore. Now, the work would basically be pulled by the CST manager from the PMO, because there is always a laundry list of things that have to be done. And the work would typically be allocated to the teams. And then they would complete the activities. And I'll tell about how they would do that. And then that would go on to the QA team. QA team would validate that and then go send it back to the tech support. So process by itself was pretty simple. But what we did, something over and above that, was something which helped us to achieve that. What we did was we said we will impose a work in progress limit. In fact, we didn't know anything about Kanban, like I said. So there was no understanding of Kanban. The only thing we said was one person will work on only one thing at a time. That's how it started, actually. We didn't even call it WIP. I use WIP here label when I've started to give talk about that. But that those days, we never even used that. We said one person will work on only one issue at a time. And when you are done with that, you go and talk to the CST manager so that you can choose what is the next thing that has to be done there. So by default, what tend to happen is that the work in progress then became, I'll come to this one. So the work in progress was kind of there. And since we had 15 people, the work in progress was 15. So it was a fixed work in progress, and there is no way people could do that. Now, you might say, that's a bad idea. Anyone who has done Kanban will say that's a bad idea, because what if I get stuck there? I need to have some way. Till that gets unblocked, I'll be able to do that, right? Now, honestly speaking, we didn't know any better. So we just said it's a natural thing for us to work on one. If we run into problems, then we are going to change it. Maybe we'll make work in progress as two. Luckily, that didn't happen. We were just plain and lucky. We were not smart. We were just lucky that it didn't happen. But this is how we really did that. Now, what would happen is, each of these 15 people is working on some issue. Looking at the issue, there is no way we can say that any of these 15 is going to be done in 1 week, 2 week, 3 week, 4 weeks. It is all random. Some issue might take 1 week, some issue might take 2 days, some issue might take 4 weeks, and so on. So what would happen is, as you can imagine, if I want to continue the same cadence on the QA side of the equation, I cannot really say that the work in progress will be that much. So we created a different work in progress notion, and we said the work in progress is 1 week. That means whatever is the number of issues in that 1 week period, that will be taken care of by the QA team, consumed, tested, and then it would be sent on a weekly basis to the tech support. So it might happen that one particular week I have two bugs and one feature request going into that. The next week I might have four bugs going, and the week after that I might have nothing going there. So we created a time box here, but the outcome of the throughput of that time box was not known. It could not be ascertained. We still followed estimation, even though if you see in David Anderson's Kanban, he talks about no estimation. We frankly, 10 years back, there was no conversation happening that estimation is good or bad. We just estimated. If you ask me to do today, I would still estimate it, even though I would say I would follow Kanban. The simple reason being, like I said, testing was an extremely involved process. We had to set up a lot of test data generators and routers and all that stuff, right? So if I have to do that level of thing, I need to know when is the likely time I'm going to need it, otherwise I will have my tech support not being able to give the commitment outside. So testing was more a way, estimation was more a way to really forecast what resources we would be needing at in what point in time, just so that we could make more realistic assessments of that. So then this would happen, for the entire thing, the estimation would happen for everything, just so that we know by which time it's going to land into the QA's column, so that they are in a position to plan for it. Yes. Yeah, but then what would happen is one thing might come take 2 weeks, another is taking 4 weeks, some is taking 1 week. Now QA doesn't know when can I expect it. So if that bug requires a particular device driver to be tested, I need to keep the setup ready. Now if I'm already resource constrained, then I want to be able to flag it upfront and not really manage with the crisis. So that was the whole idea there. Sorry. Yes. No, so what would happen is, see, let's say some particular GUI issue is there and that takes 1 week. At the same time, there is a device driver that takes 4 weeks. Now, on the week one, at the end of week one, the QA would pull the work which has been completed by the GUI team and anything else that's been delivered at that time. And then they would kind of lock the gates after that. And then they would take 1 week to do the QA on that. They would validate it. If it is not acceptable, they would give it back to the developers. If it is good, then they would send it to the tech support. They would take a week and then they would send it to the tech support. So this worked for us. Another thing which we had never discovered or stumbled upon was the concept of queue. So we didn't really know what was a queue at that time. And we just didn't have any queue. So we did not really earmark something there, which actually to me, if I think of it, it was a blessing because we didn't go with, sorry. It was a team that we made an agreement that one person will only work on one issue at a time. Once it is complete, then only you can sign up for something. So the WIP became a team agreement, really. The PMO, the program manager. The program manager was actually working very closely with the tech support. The program manager had access to, from the sales side of the equation, who were the largest customers, who were the most unsatisfied customers, how long the bug is open. So we had a complex metrics to basically arrive at that. So this was a team which was only meant for sustaining. But then in sustaining, they were for the existing versions that were already in the market, if any new feature request came, they would also enter the same queue. Yes. Yes, but then there was a new, So this was a team, 15-member team, which was only looking at the products that were already out there in the field. There was another 50 people, 70 people team, which was working on the new products that would be released in next 3 months, 6 months, 9 months time period. So they were, like I told you earlier, see what we would do is because we had the, we created the cumulative hotfix process. So what would happen is the SP branch would come and then if you see the gold branch would continue there for the next version. And when the SP branch, the service pack branch, cumulatively we are putting all the cumulative hot fixes, 1, 2, 3. After that, let's say we say we are done with that, we might do a regression round and we release the service pack. And then at that time, we carve out a new branch and roll all the changes back into the main line here. So the main line continues there. But see, what was one of the bigger problem was people were checking in some of the raw code inside the main line, which was then interfering with some of the new features that we were developing. So then we said, let's separate this, service pack is happening, and then we merge it. We still had challenge, but what would happen is cumulative hotfix process made sure that when we were doing a weekly here, even though it was not a full-blown regression, a lot of times they would circle through the issues there on a weekly basis. So by the time the service pack is get the service pack branch is getting merged into the main line, it has already been tested multiple times. So most of the major issues would kind of be discovered by that time and done that. Yeah, sorry. This was a separate QA team. Yeah, glad you asked that. We had a separate development team, 15 people, and we had 3 or 4 people QA team as well, which was dedicated only for this activities. Yes. Yeah, because the QA were only responsible for the black box QA. The developers were responsible for any kind of white box testing that they had to do. The developers would, the QA was a small cross-functional team. People knew that the wireless, somebody knew the Ethernet, somebody knew this, and they would pull in the knowledge and do that. And what we found more was by trial and error that that small team of 3 to 4 people was reasonably, because at any point in time, this development team's throughput was only on an average on a weekly basis 3 to 4 bugs. So they were able to kind of do that. So they were actually, they were more fungible. The QA team was more fungible that in the sense that they could adapt to different things rather than the QA development team. Some of the products were similar. For example, the device driver, if I change, let's say in my wireless card, I'm changing the device driver. That is not just for one product, it is across 5 products, that same device driver has to be now tested. Yes. Not really. They were very clear that, hey, I mean, most of the time it would not be the case, because at least like a device driver and GUI were two different things most of the time. I'm sure there must have been some random thing, but I would call that out as not significant number. What's that? So if the QA team, so when we initially started the process, what would happen is the developers would not be able to pick up the new work till the QA team has certified that this is okay or I can send it to tech support. Only then they would sign up for a new work. Yes, but the problem is, over a period of time, what happened was, in fact, QA guys knew, there was even like few of the guys, they said, you have done it, I know it's going to work. See, the process, process is not something. I'll tell you, this was a team with 0 attrition. See, that's the point. Our mental model is, first of all, we say that sustaining is not the glamorous job. Nobody wants to do that. And we said, this was a team that I managed for 1.5 years with 0 attrition. In fact, we had to dismantle the team later on because we ran out of bugs. And people were not very happy with that because they lost the identity. They created an identity which was all over the company. And of course, I was their cheerleader basically, because my job as head of the operations was to make sure I'm cheerleading for them. And we created literally a cult out of the whole thing. So they were very unhappy when we had to do that. Not a single person left that team actually. So I'll talk about that. So this is how we did that basically, a very simple way, where we managed there. So there was no real queue in that sense in terms of saying that, hey, this has to be the next. We were really very dynamic. So the PMO was basically always looking at and constantly prioritizing like a product. Sorry, Sarabjit, you had a question as well. Right. Okay. Probably, yeah. Yeah. Right. Possible. So we would typically actually what we would do at that point in time, till we have found a solution that works in the customer premises, we would not roll that into the main line. So our strategy was we would only roll those changes back into the main line. Once the tech support says good to go, customer says I'm happy with that, then we would roll that in. Because we realized earlier that kind of thing also created problems for us because we were too soon to roll them into the main line. On the main line? Possible. That's possible. And that's what we would sort out during the integration of that dot release and that QA. Yeah. Yeah. So they will go back, they will send it back, it again goes back. Now you again have to assess how much time it's going to take. You literally have to decide, because that guy says, hey, oh no, I didn't take care of that, maybe it's going to take another 2 days. If QA says, I can still accommodate that in that cycle because my test setup is ready. If you can give it to me, then it's good enough. Because we were a small organization, we didn't really have to. But if the QA said, hey, I'm already in last 2 days, I don't want to take this, it's the risk is too high, then we would move it to the next week. Every week. Yeah, so every week there was a lag between the what the developers are doing and the QA is doing, and then there is an outcome that's coming out. It was like a wagon train. Every week the wagon train is leaving, and the wagon train has a work in progress of 1 week. And after 1 week, it is delivering to the tech support. Now, tech support would also do some QA, maybe half a day, 1 day, 2 day, 2 hours, and then they would release to the customer. Yes. Yeah, it correct. Yeah. I don't remember what we were using that time. Maybe we were on DDTS, I think, at that time. It won't come in the priority if it doesn't have the right business priority. So we had 6 or 7 parameters. The volume of business, the fact that this was a for, see, not all customers are equal. As much as we don't like to hear it, the reality is not all customers are equal. Some customers are more equal than others. So if there is a customer who is giving me 30% of the business, I'm probably more likely to understand their pain point and find a way to do that. So even if there is a seven that's coming there, maybe I'll have to find a way to do that. So the PMO was responsible because he was the most business facing. When I say business facing inside the organization, he would talk to the field guys, he would talk to the sales guys, he would talk to the CEO, he would talk to, if the CEO, somebody picked up the phone and called the CEO and said, hey, I'm not happy with this, he was the guy who would get to know that. So he knew, and we all trusted his process. Nobody tried to second guess and said, hey, Don, why are you doing it? His name was Don. He said, why this bug should not be here. We would go with Don because Don had a transparent process and that used to work. So, yes, because these were all individual things. So typically what we have found is, at least the way, like in the last 10 years, now Kanban has got more mainstream. People are using it for more development as well. 10 years back, whatever people were beginning to do was really this kind of pattern where individual, even though I won't really say that there was no interaction, because sometimes people would talk to each other. This team was all set up ground up actually. They were not people with deep experience in the product. Like I said, 2003 is when I set up the group, 2004 is the story. So they were still learning a lot about the product. So they were experts on UI, product, backend, database, device driver. But you are right to the extent that they were working independently. And that kind of worked pretty well for us. But it does not stop us from really making some kind of a crew, like a feature crew or some 2 or 3 people working together so that they could work on a single Kanban item. That is also equally possible in doing it. I'm sure Mahesh is sitting here and probably he would, sorry if I just put you in a spot, but I'm sure as a maker of Kanban tools, they would have that ability that it's not just one particular individual pulling the card, but there couldn't be a group of people also pulling the cards when they need to do that. So I would probably look at that. So let me just complete what's there. So what is happening is, it's not originally stated as the vision or goal, but work in progress was being limited to the number of team members. So that's how we ended up accidentally doing it. At any time, one developer is assigned only one piece of work, thereby achieving a one-piece flow. So we were not really having kind of episodic flow. It was one single piece that was really flowing through the system. The new work is only assigned when the current work is completed or canceled or stalled, and the team member is available. So if the work was likely to be stalled for a longer period of time, then we allowed people to pick up another piece of work. But if it is 1 day or 2 days, then people were expected to kind of, either learn more about the code or find some way to code review or do something, but not really pick up another work there. There was no wait state or switching cost at an individual level. So the context switching cost that typically happens when people are switching between the work did not happen. We had a smaller lead time for bugs in contrast to the lead time for a service pack. The lead time for service pack was 3 months. But what was happening was that 85, 80, 90% of those bugs would be completed within 1 week, 2 week, 3 weeks, but they had to wait because of the nature of the 3 month episodic release there. That we were able to improve. The process of allowing weekly deployment of each of the hot fixes, that happened. And finally, the flexibility gained was not a zero-sum game. There was no penalty on performance in rest of the process. So we were able to do that. So let me show you a few graphs and then I will stop. How did this move the needle? If somebody picks up a bug and starts working on it, that's their individual discretionary effort. We have nothing against it, but they cannot shortchange the commitments. If they have made a commitment on something that I'm going to deliver it after 2 weeks, they are not allowed to decommit it just because they feel they want to work on something else. So we did not stop people from picking up some new piece of work as long as they did not go back on their commitment part of it. If that's what, Okay, let me show you some of the graphs that was there. So we moved from service pack to cumulative hotfix while maintaining the high quality. So if you see what is happening is, let me see if I can show you. This blue line here is actually the failure rate. And these yellow ones that you see are the ones that is actually the number of hotfixes we are doing. So for example, here in 2003, onwards, when we were not doing too many hot fixes, we were doing more of service packs. In fact, if you see the first one, it was all service packs here. And then we gradually move here, too many service packs, and eventually started doing more of hot fixes. Now, we had a major quality problem at this point, actually, when the acceptance rate was only 80%, but over a period of time, we again improved it, and we were able to maintain it to almost 95% of. Which means 95% of the times when developers completed a bug, the QA guys did not have to send it back. RTQA, the return to QA did not happen. They worked the first time and they were able to send it to them. Increase in the number of bugs with homes we were able to do. So if you see here, the number of bugs that had homes was only about 50% by and large, which actually came down beyond it. But over a period of time, we were able to do that, and we were able to, our goal was 80% of the time it should be with a home, which we were able to accomplish reasonably well. Total bugs open was an interesting number, because if you see here, this is all actually Sev1, Sev2, Sev3, even Sev5, all put together across all the products. This is what we were going into. So we had about 120, 140 bugs open, and then we started working on it. Because we went, so the classical thing of go slow so that you can go faster worked for us. We were able to reduce this and we were able to come it down. Actually, this number doesn't tell the story because this is 40 bugs across all the products in the company that were open at that point in time, which essentially meant per product we had only single digit. That none of the product had more than a single digit of bugs actually. They were all under 10. That was the point till which we tracked it and kind of there. Average days open, I was telling you, if you see the average days open of all the bugs, like here you will see the horror stories actually. The average is coming down to about 300 days to 400 days kind of a thing with different Sev1, Sev2, Sev3s going on, which we were able to bring it down to about 125 days. Now you might say that still sounds very high, but compared to what we were doing before, we were able to dramatically bring it down. It's almost half of the reduction, and that was within the acceptable ranges actually. People motivation, like you were asking about it, started with 16 people development team, zero attrition in the team. Once the backlog started coming down, the engineers were ramped down to the team to do new features. So what we did was we said, hey, this team is not required to have 16 people anymore because the work doesn't exist. The team was created to solve a problem that didn't exist anymore. So we said, we started ramping it down. At some point in time, we had only 6 or 8 people left in the team, in which case we said, let's roll them back into their respective development team. So we dismantled the team because the job was done. So this is how we were basically able to do that and do that. I will have to skip because I've almost come down to the time, but I've just added in the deck actually a little more about Kanban. This is later day Kanban, which when David Anderson's book came out. So basically visualize the workflow, represent the work items and workflow on the card wall. We didn't do any of that thing because honestly, these principles have emerged much later on. Limit work in progress was something that we accidentally stumbled upon because that's one of the big things there. Measure and manage the flow. Well, we didn't explicitly do anything to manage the flow. We were just tracking the bugs and we were just making sure that we were sticking to the work in progress. Make process policies explicit. Everybody knew this was the hotfix process. This is how you have to check in. This is how everybody is allowed to only take up one at a time. This is how the program manager is going to allocate the priority and so on. Use models to evaluate improvement opportunities. So we basically looked at improvement because when we said, hey, that many bugs are not there, let's find a way to optimize the team, and we started kind of dismantling the team. So just to give a point of view, why Kanban in software engineering? I think it's important because it makes sense not to build features that nobody needs right now. Don't write more specs than you can code. Don't write more code than you can test, and don't test more code than you can deploy. A lot of times we make the classic mistake that we actually write so much of code, then we cannot test it, it's lying there, and then we test it and we cannot deploy, and when you deploy it, nobody is able to use that. So at least we were able to do that. I'll stop here on the last slide, just to tell you what did we learn. The process improvement should be driven by business needs, not because some process looks sexy. I think it's important, and many a times, a lot of us really read the airline magazines that says, hey, this is a new version of Agile, go and do that, and the CEO comes back to the office and says, guys, let's do this kind of a thing. I think that is all nonsense. We should solve the problems. That to me is most important. So drive it by the business needs rather than saying that, hey, I want to be first in the race to deploy that process. Don't let a process limit your potential. Think beyond gurus. Like in our case, honestly speaking, we believed in the crowdsourced knowledge that we all represented as developers and test engineers and product guys. We said, there is no process, we will create it. We did not blame the process. We did not adopt a wrong process. We just tweaked what was the most natural thing for us to do. So I think there is a need for us to really recognize that it is all common sense, and we can actually do a better job than that. And don't let the absence of a process limit your potential. Do whatever it takes to serve the customer better. So these were the few things that we learned out of that process. Like I said, it's been 10 years. In fact, most of the people in Dev and QA team in that company are still there. I was the guy who ran away from there, but most of the people are still there. This was a great study for us in human motivation as well, because my mental model at that time was also, people in India don't like to do sustaining, people in India don't want to fix bugs and test it all the time, but we created a system where people were not only willing to do that, they technically were challenged, but they did not even leave the team. So that's how it was. I've run out of time, I've taken 5 minutes more, so I'll stop here now. If there's only one or two questions, I can take it. Meanwhile, the next speaker, I would request them to come and kind of set up if they want to. But till the next speaker comes, I'll probably go on. So it was all manual. It was basically manual. We had to scavenge the hardware, software, and do that. So yes, you are right, but we had to do that. Yes. So there was no pushing into production. We literally were shipping the bug as an exe, as an executable file. Tech support would either ship a CD or they will just email it to them. There was no Dropbox, so they would just like email it to them. Yes. Because we had a problem. The problem was that we were looking at this increasing pile of bugs. My SVP in San Jose, he told me, he said, TV, you guys have to fix this issue. For me, it became the top priority. I literally would have lost the job if I did not fix it. So that was the business urgency for us to do that. And I was chartered to do that. I joined the company to do that. But I was not able to do because the way we were structured, so we had to look at the org structure of separating out these two things, create a different process, create a different tool, create different policies to do that, and then it worked for us. It didn't work by only changing one piece in that jigsaw puzzle. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you. If there's anything, you can talk to me. Thanks.